Well, the Hammond Chamber had a big turnout for Governor John Bel Edwards coming home as his 8 years in office heads to an end. And with us, we have Gerald Sticker, of course, candidate for sheriff here in Tangipahoa, one of the many here at Southeastern. But what's your impression? You know, it's not every parish that ever has a governor of Louisiana.
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, Governor Edwards is our hometown governor, and it was good to see him back. You know, as his tenure as governor is winding down, and in his words, he's going to work every day to the last day and finish strong, and I wish him the best as he winds out his term.
Well, in the meantime, on the local crime front, many were shocked at the 9 indictments and, in fact, 9 guilty pleas to the feds for gang activity in Tangipahoa, activity that included even a murder. So it doesn't get any more serious than that. What do you make of it? It expanded over several years, but still very disturbing headlines.
Absolutely. You know, too many communities are dismissive of gangs. You know, but there's an old saying that you're wannabes or you're gonna bees. You know, they dismiss more deviant or less deviant behavior as, well, they're just acting like a gangster or whatever. But those wannabe gangsters are going to be gangsters. And the old saying, as we think, so we do, and so we become. And so we need to, you know, address it at a young age with education, and also when it gets up into enforcement, and take a strong stance on it. These individuals are organized. There's a drug nexus there. There's a, you know, a gun nexus, violent crime. It just all feeds, and it's like any other business. And these gangs are business. It's all about the money and all about generating money, and but the methods that they do to get their money are unscrupulous.
Interesting you would say that, because we heard from the superintendent, Melissa Stilley, at this very meeting that poor students are the ones who become criminals. The percentages of criminals who can't read, functionally illiterate, it's a great majority.
Absolutely. Look, you know, human nature, man will find his way in life, and so whatever that path may be, whether it's through legitimate means or nefarious means, if he can't get it, so you know, we just got to do our due diligence and invest in our children, invest the time in them. You know, today we're policing kids that haven't been parented, and when they get into the schools, because they haven't been parented, the schools can't control them. Then they get out into the real world and they can't get a job because they don't want their boss telling them what to do. And then they meet that law enforcement officer, and they don't want that law enforcement officer telling them what to do. And so it starts, you know, in the school. Years ago, you know, I was a school resource officer. I worked in our public schools for about 2 years as a state certified school resource officer. I worked with students, I worked with teachers, I worked with counselors. I was also a DARE instructor, you know, back when, you know, DARE was a prevalent thing, you know, and we just need to hit those children at a young age, as, you know, like my parents say, before they turn into a teenager and they know everything. Get them at a very young age, educate them, set them on that right path, and work with those families, work with the students at the school. And then, you know, there's all these organizations, Boys Club, Girls Club, you know, the Scouts organization, the churches. There's so many resources out there that we can use to shore those young people up. And too many times, it should be the family unit, should be mom and dad's position to do that. But this is real world, and there's too many kids that are parented by a single parent, one way or the other, and it just breeds dysfunction, and dysfunction breeds eventually criminal activity.
So what other issues are you hearing on the campaign trail?
Just theft, you know. There's property crimes, crimes of violence. Like I said, we just had this homicide up on the north end, domestic related. You know, we got to get a handle on the crime, Ken. When I was chief of police, the organization that I ran, we were 15 minutes from the South Shore. We policed that jurisdiction professionally. We policed it aggressively. And they knew they didn't come to our city and commit crimes and get away with it. And that's the way I will be a sheriff. I'm not putting up with it.
But everything gets back to money, or so it would appear. And we have one of the least funded sheriff's departments in the state on a per capita basis. What do you do?
Absolutely. Look, money drives everything like any other business. It's my understanding that Tangipahoa Parish Sheriff's Office is the second lowest funded sheriff's office in the state. It's unsatisfactory, but as I see it, we're in a catch-22. The citizens aren't real happy with the job overall that's being done. And that's not on those deputies. They're doing the best they can, but they're underpaid, they're overworked, and so the citizens aren't, the way I see it, the citizens aren't going to give them a raise because they're not happy with their performance, and they can't do a better job because, you know, they're only going to get X amount of dollars from the taxpaying citizen. So, look, the two top people paid in my administration, one's going to be a professional CPA, and the other one's going to be a grant writer. There are grants out there, state, federal grants for everything, for jails. I was hired under a COPS grant in 1995. And so the federal government paid my salary for the first year, and then the city picked it up after that. There are grants out there, but there's no excuse. You know, well, we don't have the money, or whatever the excuse may be. Look, you know, we're playing the fiddle while Rome's burning. We need to get a handle on the crime. The reserve division of that sheriff's office, from what I understand, is pretty much decimated. The very few reserve officers, reserve deputies. I'm going to build those numbers. I started as a reserve police officer, and it's two categories of people that I love for reserve deputies that are young men and women that are looking to get into law enforcement full time. They get to cut their teeth in their prospective profession, and it's an ongoing job interview for me because I get to see how that man or woman handles himself on the street before I give them a full-time position. The other category of reserve is that man or woman that's a retired law enforcement officer full-time. Look, they want the camaraderie, they still like to do the job, but they're retired and they have a wealth of institutional knowledge, a wealth of experience, and I'm gonna put those people back to work. Substations in LaRonja, you know, Robert up on the north end, I'm gonna find men and women in those prospective communities, and whether it be reserves or hire them full-time, and I'm putting them work in their own communities. So there goes the response times. And, you know, we're just saying that we can't do it because we don't have the money is not an excuse. There's got to be workarounds, and that's why as sheriff, look, I'm the only one not associated with the sheriff's office currently or past, good, bad, right or wrong. I'm going to bring a fresh set of eyes, a fresh energy to that sheriff's office, and I'm going to get down, and we're going to do the best we can with what we got. And I'm going to ask those men and women of that sheriff's office just to, you know, to dig in. And we're going to run at sheriff's office like any other business. We're going to get the calls on time, give them a professional response. And, you know, we're following up after that call for service to ensure that the citizens get what they need. I had a lady message me just last night, Ken. It was, you know, big, long paragraph, private Facebook message. Her nephew died of a drug overdose in November. Sheriff's office took the complaint, investigated the call, and still today there's no arrest have been made. They know the individual that administered the drugs to this victim, to this individual that died of a drug overdose. That's a second degree murder charge. We did it routinely in Mandeville. If we can prove who administered a lethal dose of narcotics to an individual, there's a clause in the second degree murder statute. And it's just things, complaints like that I get from people all the time that says, look, you know, we're supporting you, but this is the problems we're having. We get no service. The detective won't call us back. We can't get anybody at the agency to call us back. It's just zero response. There, it just appears that, you know, they're checked out on them, and it's uncalled for.
That's great.